Everything looks normal. Then this guy jumps out of a 17th floor building and falls straight down. He's in good health. Nothing's wrong. So do you know how disconnected our society is? The first phone call my sister-in-law made on that day was to my nephew, Andrew, who works in PwC, to ask Andrew, "Andrew, are you there?" "Yes." "Are you okay?" "Yes." "Is everything fine?" "Yes." But from looking at him, Stephen Olungo looked fine, he looked well. I don't know how far this is will go in terms of being a motivational speech, but motivational, I hope to get you somewhere to think about some of these things that we have a tendency to ignore. And the challenge for us will be resolving some of the forces that pull us in different directions in our lives and seeing how it is that we can balance these forces so that we can live long, productive lives. And I say this because over the last 5 or 6 years, as I got into my 40s, I have begun to realize that not everything is what I'm seeing. It isn't. I teach Sunday school. And in teaching Sunday school, it means that I receive children. I teach a 4 to 5 year olds. 4 to 5 year olds. So I receive the children. We play with them, we teach them, we release them. And it is about 3 or 4 years ago that I came to realize that there are some children who you see some things are not quite right about these children. It's not quite right. You can't put your finger on it. But then after a little while is when I discovered that for these particular children, what I didn't know, I had not noticed that I had never seen the mother and the father bring the children at the same time. I'd see the mom, I'd see the dad. But it never occurred to me that I have never seen the mom and the dad bring the child to the Sunday school. And these are people I know. People who sit behind me. You know, there's a corner I sit in church, there's a corner I sit. They sit like 3 or 4 rows behind me. I had never noticed. And these are high-flying corporate officers. And it's when we met at a separate event that this individual now tells me that I have been divorced from my wife for 3 years now. 3 years, I had no idea. And I teach his children every Sunday. But according to me, everything's fine. So here, as we're doing these things, you know, we've done very interesting things. We've talked about how to measure efficiency for buildings. I've seen a machine outside there that you can connect to your power source, 3D. Then you bring it into the building and it will tell you everything about the efficiency of your building and how to save power. We have dealt with the inanimate things. Have we dealt with us? You see, you're more than your Facebook image. And I'm coming to realize that very painfully. That the very people who are my heroes on Facebook, my heroes, you know, some of the people who are elected governors are my age. It is true. And then now you realize, as you watch a person's life unravel, you know, who knew about Homa Bay before the last, like, 3 months? Who had heard about Homa Bay here? Let's be honest. Who? Raise your hands. Who had heard about Homa Bay? Now, who knows about Homa Bay today? Who doesn't know about Homa Bay now? For our visitors. There's an ongoing, I don't know whether to call it a scandal or a drama, a saga. There's just a saga going on as we speak that is getting worse and worse every single day. But some of these governors were my heroes. And when I looked at them, I looked at their entourages. I wanted to be them. But now, knowing what I know, I'm not quite so sure. But what I want to argue is this. That if I had been measuring the correct parameters in those individuals' lives, I would have known that there's something deeply, deeply wrong. How do I know this? I'm a mechanical engineer. That was my first degree. And any time power experiences resistance, what happens? What does it create? It's heat. So there must be a temperature gauge that exists that allows you to measure a person. So no matter how still you're looking, you're well dressed. You should, and I have nothing against you. No, I've never met this man before. It's not me. I don't know you from anywhere. But if you were to go by face, the way people look, an individual like the one who is in court now, regarding the certain murder of a certain girl, would be the ideal. In terms of, if you're going by Facebook profiles alone, this is the person you want in your life. Why? He's strong, he can protect you, he's armed. That one, did you see? Did you see his profile picture? Did you see the machine gun? Did you see his muscles? You know, his biceps are just dripping. That's the person that I wanted if I was a girl. But now look where it's gotten her. And the kinds of situations people find themselves. So there's a way, in my view, to measure. The same way we're measuring for buildings, there must be a way for human beings. There must be a way to measure relationships, both within your family, among your friends, and your relatives. To measure them and to see what conditions are there. And I think for me, there's a way. And I'll argue that it is possible to examine our own lives and to see where there's an imbalance and a thing that needs to be resolved so to consult it out. But again, there's also a way in which if these things are not resolved, unfortunately, the consequences will follow us far after our own lives, and you will leave those consequences for other people to deal with. So I'll tell three stories about those three areas. And hopefully by the time I finish, I'll have convinced you. Number one, check your own life. You measure. You've measured for other people, buildings. You've told us about green energy. That's fine. I love it. Excellent. Storage systems, fantastic. Well done. But what good is a power storage system, if you yourself are broken inside? You can't keep anything. You expend all the power. In fact, by the end of the day, you end up with less power than you started with. Of course, you're going to die. You know, I was talking to Simon here on Gure. I've known Simon for a long time, so he's looking very young and rejuvenated. Is he in the room before I talk about him? Yeah, he didn't always look like this, you know. I'm assuming he still works for Kenjen. He does. Eh? But there's something that changed. Who has known Simon for a long time? Yes. Did he look like this? Like 3 or 4 years ago? What colors is there? Let's start there. It was completely white. So something must have changed. And we're discussing another leader with him. And this leader we're discussing is getting more, let me say, okay, sorry, pasuka, every single day. The every day when I see him, he's getting worse and worse. This guy's just getting, I feel sorry for him. Because it seems like he's aging by the day, by the hour. I see him at 2 o'clock, and by 6:30 he looks worse. And when I saw him, it's today. And it's getting worse and worse and worse. And even before we laugh, let's remember, by the time George Bush finished his presidency, George Bush looked older than his own father. Let's be honest, by the time Barack Obama, when you compare the pictures of Barack Obama at year 0, year 4, and year 8, Barack Obama looks like Michelle's father by the time they finish. Easily. Like then someone was telling me, if you picture them, you'd think this is a man with his daughters and his granddaughters. But there must be a way for us not to end up looking like that. Because there are consequences. So as I speak, the first thing I want to do is, let's agree that there is much more to us than energy savings. It's true, energy saving is important. Green energy is great. I love the thing about solar power. I love it about all those things you mentioned. I love them. But that's not you. And that's not the entirety of what you're about. It can't just be that. There's more to us. as human beings. And we need to explore those things. In the same energy that we commit to these processes, to all these things that we're doing, we need to commit to developing our own selves. And that's the first thing that you need to resolve. There's a tension between developing yourself, on one hand, goes upwards, and developing for your organization. And if you do not resolve those particular tensions, the organization will pull you towards developing itself, not you. And unfortunately, as some of you discover for yourselves, your organization can do without you. And I mean this even if the business is yours. Even if you're the proprietor of the business, understand this. Your business can do without you. Don't imagine that you're indispensable. Can't do without you. And it will survive and be well. And in some cases, for some people here, it will do better. For you going. To the extent that if you are tempted to come back later, to just say, there, we loved you. but now that you're gone, we love you more. In that condition. So just go where you are and we'll pay you, just stay away from us. I work with family businesses, so I know that a point reaches when some leaders need to leave. And if that is not resolved, it becomes a challenge. So you have an obligation to develop yourself. First and foremost, even as you think about your organization, think about the industry, that's fine. But you have an obligation to think about yourself. How are you growing? In my first job as an engineer in a sugar factory. So because I was a trainee and I was the youngest person there, whenever meetings were held in the factory, I would be appointed to be the secretary. So it was my role to write the minutes. Now, I don't know, who knows Moroni Sugar? Why are you laughing? You better more. So as the secretary. So now, the challenge with being a secretary is this, when, especially when you're the youngest, you have to type the minutes. But there's only one typewriter in the factory. And the typewriter is with the factory manager's secretary. And the factory manager fears his secretary. It was this squat lady who had been there longer than him, and she used to have an evil eye. She just looked at him like this, and this girl just melted. So after the meeting, then he'd send me and tell me, go and tell the secretary to type the minutes. He himself would not agree to give her those instructions. He sent me to go and tell her. So the first day I came and I gave her the minutes, and I said, I've been told that the factory manager typed these, and I left them. I found those minutes in that exact place the next week during the next meeting. Exactly where I left them. And then she just said, I'll do it later. Those were her words. So I went and I was crying to the factory manager, telling her, no, hey, she's refused. Go and tell her that I've told you to tell her to type those minutes and to type them now. So I go back and I tell her, he's told me. I'll do it. So I'm in between, I'm just shuttling. Then discovered these minutes will never get typed. At that rate. So I decided to do something about it. Computers had just been introduced. Now, you know, maybe I've said that, so you guess my age. It's okay. Like I said, I've reached the age of shamelessness. I don't care. You can guess all you want. So computers were new in that factory. So I had a friend who was a computer manager. And he taught me the basics about a computer. And I learned to type. And from that, it's interesting. I developed a talent and ability for writing. And as a result, later on, I now write for newspapers and I write books. So I'm no longer an engineer, quite, but I write. So it's unconscious, but I went ahead to develop my talents and abilities even in that situation. And I want to assure you that those opportunities are there for you no matter what age you are. That right now, at this time, you can be developing talents and abilities in things that you possibly had no idea you had a gift for. And I want to encourage you, because you never know where those talents and abilities can take you. You'll never stop growing. Never stop growing. And that was exciting for me. But now you ask yourself, so now do I have the time to be doing all this self-development in quotes? I'm employed. I work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's not quite true. And I want to recommend a book. I want you to write this down, because this book really changed my life. How to live on 24 hours a day. How to live on 24 hours a day by a person called Arnold Bennett. It's free on Kindle. If you have Kindle, you can download the book for free. It's a little book, but it is profound. Arnold Bennett. That will to show you how you can discover that the time is there. It's not necessarily lost. And I love it that you're here investing your time in something like this, in self-development, coming together with other people, which is a really great thing to do. And you need to make a habit of doing this. One of the things that I was told when we went to be mentored after graduating by other professors who are more senior than us in the field, they told us this. That you should make a habit of attending events like this, even when you're not the speaker. That you come and sit and pay attention to what other people are doing and grow as a result. Because the temptation is, when you're qualified to a certain extent, and I'm talking particularly to the students, you imagine that my role will just become, deliver my content, I leave because I'm an expert. There's a lot to be gained from a forum like this, where people come to exchange ideas. And you'll be amazed at how much people, even with postgraduate degrees, will come and grow just because of sitting next to you and exchanging ideas. And it's a habit that we need to get into. And we need to invest in. So that even if it's not painful, it's something that we should gladly sacrifice money from our pockets to attend. Because we need to be growing, we need to invest energy in things like this. And the second part now is this, it's your family. And I'm not saying necessarily that for those who are married, it's just your family and the relationships of the people around you. It's interesting that when we had a conversation, we have a couple's fellowship. So just last week we sat down and we were talking among ourselves, and one of the questions that was asked, how would you know if your relationship as a couple was in the ICU, it is nearly dead? And we're asking this because very many of our couple friends split suddenly to us. That it appears that they were fine yesterday, and then today everything has gone haywire, people have moved out of home. And this was particularly close for me. I had a friend who I respected deeply, who had been married for much longer than me. In fact, he was our mentor. To a certain extent. Then one day we were moving into a new house. So I saw his car outside one of the houses and I knew, I have caught him. He has a girlfriend on the side. So I was just there waiting outside. I was just waiting for him to be mad so that I confront him and I tell him, I have caught you, my brother. So I waited and waited. It took about 2 days. Then the person who emerged from the house was not the man. Who was it?
The wife.
And that completely confused me. Because I was prepared for the man, completely. I even had the script, everything, I prepared everything, all the questions I was going to ask from number 1 to number 10, incriminating evidence, photographs. I was not prepared for the wife. So when she comes and I ask her, "Hey, okay, what are you doing?" She says it's her office. But you've been here a week. I know of no one who works in the offices for an entire week. And it turned out they had separated. And I had no idea. And as a matter of fact, when I called his friends, they had no idea. And it's unfortunate because we've gotten to this place where we are so reserved about ourselves that we don't even let people into our own lives. To ask the difficult questions. Where are you? Who was that I saw you? Why are you looking at each other like that, the two of you? And I found you at Java, and I know this is not your wife. Can you imagine if we were candid enough to ask each other questions like those? How different people's lives would be. But we don't ask. And it's a challenge. And when I confronted one of my friends just recently, again in Sunday school, and again someone who's brought his child for 4 years, he told me he has not been together with his wife for 4 years, and he's my friend. I went to high school with him. And when I asked him, how did you get to this point? He told me, no one has ever asked me about those things before. You're the first one. So I want us to encourage each other by asking those difficult questions of your friends, of your relatives. But finally, we need to see life differently. You know, now here we've talked about energy and saving and everything. That's fine. But you know, you will live forever. Did you know that? I think you didn't hear me properly, so let me say it from this side. You will live forever. I want to assure you. Let me say it again, because I think you will live forever. I was listening to a guy called Simon Sinek. Who knows Simon Sinek? You know Simon Sinek? And I want to encourage you again. This is another resource that might prove useful to you. Simon Sinek, Finite versus Infinite. And it's on YouTube. You see, there's a part of us that will not die when we die. When our bodies die, there's another part that has to go somewhere. And I get very concerned about that. That this guy might have jumped the 17 floors, that's fine. He killed the body, fine. But he didn't kill everything.
Soul.
Yes, it's something else that remains. And I have no, there's no maths here that can tell you the energy equations and I tell you the conservation of energy and this part is out and I can tell you it's a number. I don't know. But everything that we do here has a consequence. Moving forward. And that's what I want to close on. There's a reason I moved from mechanical engineering, my first degree, to entrepreneurship, my second, and to family business for my third. My father died young. He died at 54. And he died in a road accident. The tragedy in my father's dying wasn't in him dying. The tragedy in my father's dying is that he died with a mistress who we didn't know, who had children. And that story came to life when he passed on. So we were in a state of war. A state of war we have been in for the last 30 years as a family. You see, he did figure out that I'll be alive longer than I'm alive. After my body dies, things continue. And I'm talking to the young men here, specifically. Don't laugh, your turn is coming. That you can play around with girls and have sex with them indiscriminately and imagine that there will be no consequence to this moving forward, I assure you that you are mistaken. Those things will come back to bite you. And to the ladies, now that you're laughing, if you think that the end justifies the means, that whichever way you get a 20 million shilling house doesn't matter. When I'm in the 20 million shilling house, it's okay if I'm crying rather than be laughing. Poor in Bomet. You're mistaken. We live in a world, and it's increasingly becoming the case, where we imagine that there are no consequences for actions. And you can see it, even as we grapple with corruption. The people steal 400 million shillings, 500 million, 100 to a billion. And they think that as long as I've sorted it out now for my family, it will be fine going ahead. I can tell you this, that even if my dad died fairly wealthy, the money that he left us, the property he left us, does not in any way compensate for the amount of heartache and trouble that we have had to go through as a family and as individuals. And when I do an energy audit, I have expended 80% of my active life from my young 20s to where I am now, resolving that particular conflict that wasn't even mine to start with. So live your lives in such a way that those who are coming after you won't have to dedicate their lives to resolving things that you should have resolved yourself. Three things. Number one, develop yourself. Number two, take an interest in your family, the people around you, the people you love. Invest in them. Don't leave issues that you should have resolved for other generations to clean up after you.